Mr. Abel, please rise and join me in the call to worship. We see light, hope, and joy.
We bring heart, soul, mind, and body.
We share blessings and fears.
We bring faith and doubt. With all that we are, let us worship God.
Our opening hymn is 655, Sanctuary. Join with me in the prayer of illumination. God, by your word, you gave light to the soul.
Pour out of us the spirit of wisdom and understanding, that our hearts may be open to know your truth and your way. Amen.
First scripture reading is Joshua chapter 3, verses 7 through 17, which can be found on page 187 of the pew. And the Lord said to Joshua, "This day I will begin to exalt you in the sight of all Israel, that they may know that, as I am with Moses, so I will be with you. And you shall command the priests to bear the Ark of the Covenant. When you come to the brink of the waters of the Jordan, you shall stand still in the Jordan." And Joshua said to the people of Israel, "Come hither and hear the words of the Lord your God." And Joshua said, "Hereby you shall know that the living God is among you, and that he will without fail drive out from before you the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Hivites, the Perizzites, the Girgashites, and the Amorites, and the Jebusites. Behold, the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord of all the earth is to pass over before you into the Jordan. Now therefore take 12 men from the tribes of Israel, from each tribe of man. And when the soles of the feet of the priests who bear the Ark of the Lord of all earth, shall rest in the waters of the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan shall be stopped from flowing, and the waters coming down from above shall stand in one heap." Our chapter verse. Matthew 23, 1 through 12, and this can be found on page 857 of your Bible. Then said Jesus to the crowds and to his disciples, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat, so practice and observe whatever they tell you, but not what they do, for they preach, but do not practice. They bind heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with their finger. They do all their deeds to be seen by men, for they make their phylacteries broad and their fringes long. And they love the place of honor at feasts and the best seats in the synagogues and salutations in the marketplaces and being called rabbi by men. But you are not to be called rabbi, for you have one teacher and you are all brethren. And call no man your father on earth, for you have one Father who is in heaven. Neither be called masters, for you have one master, but Christ. He who is greatest among you shall be your servant. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now let's sing one verse of Jesus Loves You, and you come forward.
Why don't you practice what you preach? It says it right there on our bulletin, right? Have you ever said that? Have you had anybody ever say that to you? I have. Believe it or not, I've certainly had that said to me. I think it's one of the pastor's crosses that we have to bear. I stand up here and preach to you on Sunday, but do I really practice what I preach? Hypocrites are people who pretend to be something they are not. They may say one thing and do the opposite. They may act one way in a certain setting and then act a different way in a different setting. It is very important that as Christians, and we do call ourselves Christians, that as Christians we follow the example of Jesus Christ. And it doesn't matter where we are or who we are with. The words we speak and the things we do should always reflect our faith. And sometimes we're good at telling other people what they should do and how they should live, particularly we pastors, but oftentimes we fail to follow our own instructions. I think we all need to, as the saying goes, we all need to not just talk the talk, we need to walk the walk. Shall we pray? Gracious God, may the words of my lips and the meditations of our hearts and minds be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. A long time ago, and it has been a very long time ago because I haven't seen this in the comics in a long time, I saw a Peanuts comic strip. We're all familiar with Peanuts. Charlie Brown, Lucy, Snoopy, of course. And this Peanuts comic strip, it had Snoopy on top of his doghouse. And right there with Snoopy was a small flock of young birds. Now, it was time for the baby birds to learn how to fly. And it was up to Snoopy to be their teacher. So Snoopy talked to them. He flapped his big beagle ears. He walked to the end of the rooftop there. He leaped into the air, flapping his ears, and he fell right on his head off the side of the doghouse. He got back up, went back up to the roof, and he shared this lesson with the baby birds. Do as I say, not as I do. In Matthew 23, this passage we heard this morning, Jesus tells the crowds and his disciples to do what the Pharisees and the scribes are teaching them to do, but not to do as they do, because they don't practice what they preach. In other words, the leaders there 2,000 years ago, they were talking the talk, but they were not walking the walk. Now, why is that important? Why was it important 2,000 years ago? Why is it important to us today? Well, it's important because we call ourselves Christians. And the most basic reason that it's important that we walk the walk of a Christian has to do with the integrity of our Christian faith. Because, my friends, we are the hands and the feet and the body of Jesus Christ to this world. In Matthew 5:14, Jesus tells us that you are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. People should be attracted by the light of the way that we live, if we call ourselves Christians. Whether we like it or not, people are watching us, and people are seeing how we respond to the ups and downs of everyday life. You know, children watch adults, and then they imitate what they see and what they hear. You know that. Well, are our words and the actions that we say something that, or that we do, are they something that we want repeated by children? You know, our friends, our neighbors, our co-workers, other family members, our classmates at school, they're watching us if we call ourselves Christians. So what evidence do we offer of our profession of faith, of what we profess to be as a Christian? Are our responses to the ups and downs of everyday life any different from those of people who don't profess to know Jesus Christ? And not only are non-believers watching us, but so are the Christians. People, particularly who are new to the faith, often look to more mature Christians to see how they should be living. So do our words and our actions encourage or build up other Christians? I spent some time this morning with some of our youth who have committed to being a part of our confirmation experience for 2017 and 2018. All six of those youth have agreed to meet on a regular basis and to spend time trying to figure out what it means to follow Jesus. And you know, one of the best ways they figure that out is by watching you and by observing what you do in your life, by seeing how you follow Jesus as a Christian. Do you walk the walk, or do you just talk the talk? Do you practice what you hear preached here on Sunday mornings? How do we practice what we preach? Well, a couple of ways I just want to mention briefly this morning. One way is to be very careful about the words that we speak. You know, you can tell an awful lot about a person by the words that they use. And you can tell even more about them by the words they use when they're threatened, when they're angry, when they're upset. James tells us in his small book in the New Testament that the tongue is very dangerous. He says it can set a great forest ablaze. He says that we can tame all kinds of animals, but we cannot tame the tongue. That's found in James 3, verses 3 through 6, my paraphrase of that. But I really believe that people, especially our own young people, are listening to the words that we speak. Do our words build people up, or do they tear people down? Do our words bring peace and calm to a situation, or do they add fuel to the fire? The words that we speak should match the person that we claim to be and the person that we claim to follow. If we profess that we are followers of Jesus Christ, then our words should be a reflection of that relationship. Another way in which we practice what we preach is when we live our lives, also as reflections of the life of Christ. The way that we act at work should be the same way we act here on Sunday morning in church. And also the way that we act at home, the way that we act around non-Christians, the way we act around other Christians, the way we act when we're in Country Mart, the way we act when we are in school, should be the same as we act in our Sunday best on Sunday morning. Because what you see is what you get. We should try to act the same wherever we are. We should try to act as a Christian. We should be a reflection of Jesus Christ. When people see us, they should see that reflection of Christ. Do we live our lives in ways that reflect Christ? So the question I leave with you today is this. Do you walk the walk of following Jesus in all areas of your life? Or are you just a Sunday morning Christian? Do you walk the walk of Jesus? And you don't have to respond to me to that question. You only have to answer to yourself and to God. Do you walk the walk of Jesus? Amen. What? Wait, you see that? 9 minutes and 30 seconds. Our hymn number is, I think is what we do. It's in there somewhere. This is such an exciting day. Yeah. It is possible. It is possible. Yeah, you don't think I could ever do it again. I'm not going to try. Don't worry. It's too hard. It's too hard. Okay. Let's respond to our word this morning, both our scripture and our message, by rising together and singing our hymn. response, which is on page 690, a great hymn, He Leadeth Me. Shall we rise together? Amen. With me now in that affirmation of faith we call the Apostles' Creed, by which Christians throughout the centuries have confessed what it is that we believe. I believe in
God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He ascended into heaven. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We now come to that point in our service where we have an opportunity to give of what we have received, to give back in service to our Lord and our God. So as our ushers come forward, and as we hear a special word and a song this morning, let us be generous in our offering.
Very needed at the time. And it's The story behind the song is well within my soul. And it's off of a site called saintaugustine.com, and it's written by a Dr. Lindsay Carey. Horatio G. Spafford was a successful lawyer and businessman in Chicago with a lovely family, a wife, Anna, five children. However, they were not strangers to tears and tragedy. Their young son died with pneumonia in 1871, and in that same year, much of their business was lost in the Great Chicago Fire. Yet God, in His mercy and kindness, allowed the business to flourish once more. On November 21st, 1873, the French ocean liner, Ville de Havre, was crossing the Atlantic from the U.S. to Europe with 313 passengers on board. Among the passengers were Mrs. Spafford and their four daughters. Although Mr. Spafford had planned to go with his family, he found it necessary to stay in Chicago to help solve an unexpected business problem. He told his wife he would join her and their children in Europe a few days later. His plan was to take another ship. About 4 days into the ocean crossing of the Atlantic, the Ville de Havre collided with a powerful, iron-hulled Scottish ship, the Lochram. Suddenly, all of those on board were in grave danger. Anna hurriedly brought her four children to the deck. She knelt there with Annie, Margaret, Lee, Bessie, and Tanetta, and prayed that God would spare them, that he could his will, or to make them willing to endure whatever awaited them. Within approximately 12 minutes, the Ville de Havre slipped beneath the dark waters of the Atlantic, carrying with it 226 of the passengers, including the four Spafford children. A sailor rowing a small boat over the spot where the ship went down spotted a woman floating on a piece of the wreckage. It was Anna, still alive. He pulled her into the boat, and they were picked up by another large vessel, which 9 days later landed them in Cardiff, Wales. From there, she wired her husband a message which began, "Saved alone, what shall I do?" Mr. Spafford later framed the telegram and placed it in his office. Another of the ship's survivors, Pastor Weiss, later recalled Anna saying, "God gave me four daughters. Now they have been taken from me. Someday, I will understand why." Mr. Spafford booked passage on the next available ship and left to join his grieving wife. With the ship about 4 days out, the captain called Spafford to his cabin and told him they were over the place where the children went down. According to Bertha Spafford Vester, a daughter born after the tragedy, Spafford wrote, "It is well with my soul while on this journey. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul." Anna gave birth to three more children, one of which died at age four with dreaded pneumonia in August of 1881. The Spaffords moved to Jerusalem. Mr. Spafford died and is buried in that city. "And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, shall keep your hearts, your minds, through Christ Jesus." That's from Philippians 4, verse 7. So now I would like for us to sing the first verse of "It Is Well With My Soul." It's on 705.
Thank you.
Gracious God, there are so many needs in this world. We ask now that these tokens we present to you will allow all peoples everywhere to cry, "It is well with my soul." And we claim that from you right now for our souls, because you are always with us. Take these tokens and bless them now for use throughout your kingdom on this earth. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Let us pause now for just a moment of silence as we prepare our hearts and minds for prayer. Shall we pray? Lord, we know that you're right here with us right now as we've met together in your name, and we gratefully acknowledge your presence. For you're with us not only when we meet together here, you're with us out there in our everyday world, day after day, and for that we thank you. And we do need you. We need your presence in our lives. We need your mercy. We need your grace. And we know we've done nothing to deserve your mercy, but we thank you for it. If we all got what we deserve, we'd never have eternal life. We'd never have the hope of heaven. We'd never have your presence with us. We'd never have forgiveness of sins, and we'd be lost without you in this world. So we don't ask for what we deserve. We ask for your mercy and for your grace. And we're so ever thankful that you sought us and found us and drew us to yourself. When we look around us at our world, we're often troubled and concerned. There are so many places around the world where there is no freedom, especially freedom of worship. Our world desperately needs you, O God. We pray for your kingdom to come and your will to be done on earth, just as it is in heaven. We need you too, right here, right at home in our community. There is strife and unease all around us. People are being exploited and abused through no fault of their own. They need you, and therefore they need us. So help us to be faithful to you and to them. And our God, right here in our church family, we have all kinds of needs. There are those of us that face physical problems, and we need your healing touch. There are those that need your touch on them emotionally and spiritually to encourage and lift them up. Some of us are facing other difficulties, and we need the assurance of your presence with us. Some may be facing financial difficulties, and so they need your direction and your guidance right now, this very week. Answer prayer for them and for each of us in special and indefinite ways, O God. And for each and every one of us, look down inside and see the hurt and the feelings that we have, the discouragements and the frustrations, and all those ways that we desperately need you. We ask that you continue to meet us at the very point of our need today. Our God, we ask now that you continue to be with us as together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory of God. Amen." Let us now rise together one last time, either in body or in spirit, and sing our closing hymn, number 358, Because He Lives. So we stand and sing. Inside us as well.
So go in peace these days, Martha. Amen.